ISUPK.
You done heard a thousand times before that there's no history of the Israelites ever being in Egypt, right? What if I told you that I found the city of the Hebrews in Egypt, hidden in plain sight? And I'm going to bring it out at the Passover. This Passover 2016. I'm going to drop today's word.
You say shalom. Welcome to Thursday night here in the ISUPK history class in Philadelphia. I'm your teacher, priest, and officer, Soccer Wall. Start the class off with questions. Anybody in the class have a question? Question on anything about everything pertaining to the Bible or life or anything you curious about? All right, no questions. Well, tonight we're going to go into the topic of the cruelty of the white man. The white man is the most cruel, murderous, raping, robbing beast that has ever existed on the planet Earth. The Bible prophesies this about the white man. And tonight we're going to go into some history about a particular period in which the white man's cruelty plagued our people in the earth. Has anyone ever heard of the Spanish Inquisition? They might know what the Spanish Inquisition is. Akim in the back, coming to the class. Anybody in the class know what the Spanish Inquisition is? Okay. I'm going to read a little bit of history about the Spanish Inquisition. Then we're going to go into the scriptures about the white man and his wickedness and his cruelty that the Most High prophesied about, all right? Boom. The Spanish Inquisition was a time period from 1478 to 1834, all right? I'm going to read the history on it. It says, this, in 1478, the Spanish Inquisition was established by the papal approval of Pope Sixtus VI, or the Fourth, Salah. The reform and extension of the ancient tribunal, which had existed from the 13th century, was mainly to discover and eliminate Jews and Muslims secretly taking up their beliefs in private. So during the Spanish Inquisition, who was being targeted in Spain, in Europe? Anybody? Officer Sharmov.
The Jews and the Muslims.
The Jews and the Muslims. Who are the Jews and the Muslims? Sharmov.
The 12 tribes of Israel and the Ishmael.
Okay. Anybody else? Who were the Jews and the Muslims? Well, what were the Jews and the Muslims known as during this time in history? It's between 1478 and 1834. Collectively, what were the Jews and the Muslims known as? Marat.
Was we known as the Byzantine Empire?
Not in this part of Europe. The Byzantine Empire was in Eastern Europe, in the parts of the world today we know as Turkey, Russia, Syria, all the, that part of the world was the Byzantine Empire or Eastern Europe. People today who don't want to claim being a Jew or being a Muslim, but they claim their ancestry goes back to Europe, or North Africa, what do they call themselves? Black Americans today. Sis.
The Moors.
The Jews and the Muslims during this time period in history collectively were known as the Moors. What does everybody know about the Moors? Well, not their religious affiliation, but their racial identity. Sis and I, that they were black. The so-called Moors in Europe between the 13th century and the 18th century, which is between 1100 and 1700, were black. They were dark-skinned people. The Spanish Inquisition was designed to target the Jews and the Muslims. It was designed to target the blacks. Who were the people behind the Spanish Inquisition? Who were the people who were ruling in Rome? The Roman Catholic Church. If the Moors were black, then what were the Romans or the Roman Catholics? Marat.
The white people?
They were white. They were the white people. The Spanish Inquisition was a period in history. You want to say something? Non toi. You can set some aside for me. The Spanish Inquisition was a time period when the white man started to resurrect himself in the earth as a power. And from his seat in Rome, he used the religion of Catholicism to force his way of life onto people who were weaker than them. You understand? The Spanish Inquisition was the white man's way of targeting black people who had power, who had authority, who had wealth in Europe during that time. As I read on about the Spanish Inquisition and what brought it about and what the policy was, you're going to see that this policy that the white man had of dealing with the Jews and the Muslims is very much what we all know to be the legacy of slavery here in America, that we are the descendants of today. All right, so I'm going to read on a little bit more. The conduct of this holy office greatly weakened the power and diminished the population of Spain. So what it says, the conduct of this holy office, meaning this thing that the Pope decided to do, greatly weakened the power and diminished the population of Spain. What does that mean? That means all of the mighty, strong people and wealthy people were dying. And a lot of them were dying. If it weakened the power and diminished the population, that means this thing is like genocide. It's wiping out everybody. It says, it was considered the most deadliest and notorious of all inquisitions, as firstly being it was the most highly organized, and secondly, it was far more exposed and open with the death penalty than that of the papal inquisition. So before this time period, there was another inquisition that was called the papal inquisition. The papal inquisition was the Pope himself saying, these people are speaking against me. They're speaking against the Pope, speaking against what we teach. We got to lock them up. We got to kill them. They say the Spanish Inquisition was worse because it was more organized and the penalty was death. All right. It says, this holy office became veiled by secrecy, unhesitatingly kept back, falsified, concealed, and forged the reports of thousands of trials. So the people that was getting locked up and dealt with because of this Inquisition, it was a undercover operation. You understand? It wasn't something that was highly publicized. It wasn't something that the common person was really able to understand what was happening. It was just people was getting snatched up, then they disappeared. It says the Catholic, so like the first two inquisitors in the districts of Seville were appointed in 1480 by King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella. Does anybody know anybody else? I'm sorry. Does anybody know what else King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella is famous for? Sis. Slavery. Why? Who did they deal with? Who did they help out, sis? No, not yet. They ain't get to the Africans yet. They helped somebody else who started slavery. Who started slavery in the Western Hemisphere? They celebrating the day in America, sis.
Columbus.
Christopher Columbus. King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella were the ones who gave Columbus the money that he needed in order to sail his ships over here to America. King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella were the ones that gave Columbus the permission to kill and murder and enslave the native Indians in the name of Christianity, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So this same king and queen who began the murder of our people in the Western Hemisphere, you understand, that was already here in America, they're the same ones that started the murder of our people in Europe. They're the same ones that started the end of the Dark Ages in Europe, all right? I'm gonna read a little bit more. It says, the first two inquisitors in the districts of Seville were appointed in 1480 by King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella to round up the most wealthiest heretics. The reason for this was that the property of those accused was shared equally between the Catholic throne and the Dominicans. Now, the Dominicans was a family that lived in Europe during this time. They were a Catholic family that was wealthy and had influence. That's where the name Dominican Republic comes from over here in the over there that shares the island with Haiti. That name, the Dominican Republic, came from this family of rich devils that was in Spain during the time of the Renaissance era, when the white man started to reemerge himself in power in Europe. Come on with it.
So the original name Dominican comes from the white man.
Yes, the name Dominican comes from a family of crackers. You understand? So everybody calling themselves Dominicans, the history of that name goes back to a rich family of devils that was that had close ties with the Roman Catholic Church, all right? So it says the Catholic Spanish government also directly paid the expenses and received the net income of the Inquisition itself from the accused. According to civil law, people convicted of religious treason were sentenced to death and their goods confiscated, while the Catholic Church feasted on their estate. Additional inquisitors were named, including Tomas Torquemada, who the following year was appointed Inquisitor General for all of Spain. Tomas, whose duty was to organize the rules of inquisitorial procedures in Seville, Castile, and Aragon. He believed punishment of heretics was the only way to achieve political and religious unity in Spain. Those refusing to accept Catholicism were led to the stake and burnt alive in a procession and Catholic ceremony known as Auto de Fe, or Act of Faith. All right, so that's a brief history of the Spanish Inquisition. Here's a picture here. You see people hanging up on the stakes. You see the smoke rising from them being burned, and you see more people being lined up to be murdered, all right? Come on with it.
So the people they're burning is not white people.
No, they're not. They are people who don't believe in Catholicism, who never really believed in Catholicism. Marat.
The Israelites.
The Israelites. The people who would, the people that refused them. Aside from that, right? Who are the people that are world famous for refusing to give up their belief? Refusing to turn their back on their God. Refusing to give up their culture and their laws and their way of life, sis. Who? Okay. Where did the Muslims get their belief from? Okay, no, I don't think that.
Okay.
Muslims been their belief all the time. Black Muslims in America, right? What are Muslims never supposed to do? There's some things that Muslims used to stand for, right? What are some things the Muslim used to never do? Used to never eat pork. What else? Used to never smoke. What else? Drink. Curse. Hurt their people. What are Muslims are they doing? Eating pork. Drinking. Going to the strip club. Having hoes. Smoking weed. They bend their belief. They don't stand strong on what it is they believe in. But there's a people on this planet that are famous for dying before they'll give up their belief. They written about in history. These people would die before they would give up their belief, give up their God, give up their culture and their way of life. Who are those people? Who are the people that are world famous for never giving up their culture and their belief? And what is the name of the book that you can read about them in? Anybody? Yannaquan?
The Bible.
The Bible is the book. Who's the people?
The 12
Israel. We are the people that are world famous for never giving up our belief, never turning our back on our culture, never giving up the thing that made us who we were. Throughout history, we have been famous to everybody for being the people that would die before they would give up their religion. Well, That's who the Catholics targeted with their Spanish Inquisition. They wanted to target the people who refused to give up their belief. I read earlier it said they was targeting Jews and Muslims, right? Well, we know that during the Dark Ages, black people were the ones that ruled in Europe, right? So when the white man started to reemerge in power, now, under the Spanish Inquisition, matter of fact, I should have read this first. I should have gave some history about what the Inquisition was and why it turned out to be such a horrible, evil thing, all right? I'm going to read a little bit about what the word Inquisition means, all right? Because the people hear that term, Spanish Inquisition, the word Inquisition today really just means to question someone. You understand? The root word of Inquisition is inquisitive. Somebody that's inquisitive is somebody that's curious, wanting to know something, wanting to study, wanting to learn. They real inquisitive. A kid that asks a lot of questions. Mommy, what's this? Daddy, what's that? Why is it called this? Why is it called that? Where that name come from? Why they call it a fruit and that a rabbit? You know what I'm saying? Different questions. That's because a kid is inquisitive, right? So the root word of it, the Inquisition, was inquisitive, or to ask, to search out, right? Inquisition procedure. It says the Inquisition was an ecclesiastical court and process of the Roman Catholic Church set up for the purpose towards the discovery and punishment of heresy, which wielded immense power and brutality in medieval and early modern times. So the point of the Inquisition was to find heretics or find someone that's speaking hearsay. What is hearsay? Marat.
Is it something that goes against a belief?
Okay, you close. Anybody else want to give it a shot? Shaw Moth.
Something that like a rumor.
A rumor. What should we do to find out definitively what the word hearsay means?
Look it up.
You should look it up. All right. I got my dictionary, so I'll pull it up real quick for y'all. It's a lot. It's important to understand the definitions of words such as hearsay because they are words that appear in the Bible. Everybody understand? You never want to read the scriptures and just pass over words that you don't have a definitive meaning for, all right? So here's hearsay. Hearsay is a belief or opinion that does not agree with the official belief or opinion of a particular religion. Everybody understand? So hearsay is something that goes against what is being taught. Something that goes against what is believed. Everybody understand? Well, what is hearsay against the Catholic Church? Marat.
The truth.
The truth is hearsay. Because the Catholic Church says Mary and Joseph never had sex for Jesus to be born. The truth of the Bible is that Joseph had that sex with Mary. That's how Christ got here. The Roman Catholic Church says that Christ was God. The truth of the Bible shows that the Most High is not, Christ is not the Most High, but he's the Most High Son. Everybody understand? The truth, the Roman Catholic Church say a priest can't get married. The truth of the Bible is a man can have more than one wife. Everybody understand? The truth, the Roman Catholic Church says we're supposed to pray on Sunday. That's the Sabbath. The truth of the Bible, the Sabbath is Friday sundown and Saturday sundown. Everything that the Roman Catholic Church teaches goes completely against the truth. So when the Roman Catholics started their Inquisition, who did they inevitably have to bump heads with? The people that believe the truth. The Jews, the Israelites, the ones who was keeping the law, statutes, and commandments, who was obeying the words of Christ, following in the footsteps of the disciples. Everybody understand? The Spanish Inquisition was the Roman Catholic Church targeting the brothers and the sisters who was holding on to the truth during the time of the Dark Ages, during the time of the Middle Ages. Everybody understand? I'm going to read a little bit more. It says, at root, the word Inquisition signifies as little of evil as the primitive inquire or the adjective inquisitive. But as words like persons lose their characters by bad associations, so Inquisition has become infamous and hideous as the name of an executive department of the Roman Catholic Church. All crimes and all vices are contained in this one word, Inquisition. For people who know about the Spanish Inquisition, when they hear the word Inquisition, this is what they think about: murder, robbery, arson, outrage, torture, treachery, deceit, hypocrisy, cupidity, holiness. No other word in all languages is so hateful as this one that owes its abhorrent preeminence to its association with the Roman Catholic Church. All right, let's get Jeremiah chapter 49, verse 16. We're going to go in the Bible and we're going to talk about the Most High prophesying this evil period of the white man's history pertaining to our people. You want to know how black people became Christians? You want to know how the Hispanics was forced to convert to Catholicism? If you want to know why today our people have abandoned all sense of individuality and separateness from the white man that's ruling over top of us, all you have to do is understand the Spanish Inquisition. All you have to do is understand the Bible prophesying the character of the white man. All right? Jeremiah chapter 49, verse 16. You got it?
Jeremiah.
All right, read it.
Jeremiah. I get my voice there. Got it?
Hello, what kind?
Okay. Jeremiah chapter 34, verse 16.
No, 49.
Slacky. You said 49?
Jeremiah 49, 16. No,
49?
Jeremiah 49, 16.
Jeremiah 49, verse 16. All right. The terribleness, faith, deceit thee.
Thy terribleness have deceived thee. You ain't got your glasses, Yonaquan.
So I can read.
All right, no sweat. Thy terribleness have deceived thee. Read.
And the pride of thine heart, O thou that dwellest in the clefts of the rocks, of the rock, that holdest the height of the hill.
You understand? The Lord said, thy terribleness have deceived thee. And the pride of thine heart, O thou that dwellest in the clefts of the rock, that holdest the height of the hill. This is a prophecy about the children of Edom. You understand? The Lord is talking to the white man. Two clues. The Lord saying, thy terribleness have deceived thee, O thou that dwellest in the clefts of the rock, that holdest the height of the hill. What people on the planet today are famous and world known for living in caves? For living in mountains, for living up high. Of Zaima,
white people.
So-called white man, the Caucasian race. Their name tells you where they came from. They come from mountains. They come from caves. The Lord is talking about the people who come from mountains, who come from caves. When the Lord says, thy terribleness has deceived thee, what is he talking about? He's talking about all of the tools and methods of torture and rape and fearfulness that the white man uses to instill on his enemies. Everybody understand? This Spanish Inquisition was all about the white man's terribleness. It was all about torture. It was all about striking fear in people's hearts to make them give up their belief, give up their culture, give up the things that they held true to in order to accept the white man's lies. Everybody understand? Lord said, thy terribleness has deceived thee. What is the terribleness of the white man? What was the terribleness of the Spanish Inquisition? I'm about to read to you all some of the methods the white man used in order to get people to convert to the white man's religion or to abandon their belief. Everybody understand? Because we read earlier that the end result of being found a heretic was what? What happened once they found you guilty? Sis, they put you to death. So this wasn't really about converting anybody to white Jesus. This was about torture and putting fear in other people. Everybody understand? Now, this is going to get kind of graphic. Everybody understand? It's horrible. It's going to get kind of graphic. There's some quotes from famous crackers throughout history. It says, fear is the basis of the whole. Fear of the mysterious. Fear of defeat. Fear of death. Fear is the parent of cruelty. And therefore, it is no wonder if cruelty and religion have gone hand in hand. This man's name was Bertrand Russell. Now, does everybody see what I have up here on the screen here? A couple methods of torture that have been famously used by the white man throughout history, all right? Right here, you got the gallows. See the man standing there with his head inside the thing and his arms are stuck there? That's one of the methods of torture. You see down here, the iron boot. I don't know if y'all see it, but it's a giant boot. And a man is laying down, his feet is shoved in the boot. You got some metal things in between it. There's another thing called the scavenger's daughter. This was, I don't know what the hell they did with that machine. It's a lock, I don't want to know. This thing here is called the Iron Maiden. Everybody see that? It's like a coffin, a giant iron coffin with spikes on the inside and spikes on the door. There's this thing up here is called the rack. You see where it got the little arm there and the arm there? They would lay a person flat. Their arms and legs would be attached to this rack. And as you crank the rack, it stretches the arms and the legs. All right? Now, this is just a few of the torture utensils that the white man used in the Catholic Church. All right? And we're going to go down and get to a couple of them in particular. All right? It says medieval torture devices. Reaching its peak in the 12th century, torture was used in capital cases as well as against suspected heretics. From the mid-14th century to the end of the 18th century, which is the time of the Spanish Inquisition, torture was a common and sanctioned part of the legal proceedings of most European countries, which was approved by the Inquisition in cases of heresy. So it was widely accepted in Europe that this is how you dealt with people that you wanted to punish. You torture. You put them through this hell that we're about to read about, all right? It says the most common means of torture included burning, beating, and suffocating. However, the techniques below are some of the more extravagant and depraved methods used and allowed by the Roman Catholic Church. So we're going to read about the worst of the worst of all the tools that they had at their disposal, all right? First, we have the rack. The rack was an instrument of torture often used in the Middle Ages and a popular means of extricating confession. The victim was tied across a board by their ankles and wrists. Rollers at either end of the board were turned by pulling the body in opposite directions until dislocation of every joint occurred. According to Puig Black, quoted in Mason's History of the Inquisition, in this attitude, he experienced 8 strong contortions in his limbs, namely 2 of the fleshy part of the arms above the elbows and 2 below. So what does that mean? When you tie to this device, the part of your body that holds the elbow connects the upper arm and the lower arm. Well, the point of this device was to completely separate all of that. So while you land on this machine, they turn in the rack, your elbow gets dislocated from your lower arm. They pull it some more, the elbow dislocates from the upper arm. So when they finish with you, you have arms that cannot work because they're no longer connected. You just got dangling limbs. Everybody understand? At the same time, while they're stretching you and your arms is being dislocated, the same thing is happening to your legs. The lower part of your leg is being pulled apart from the knee. Then the upper part of your leg is being separated from the knee. Everybody understand? Now, I played sports. The Lord blessed me. I never suffered an injury of tearing an ACL or breaking any bones. Has anybody ever broken a bone in here? Sis, where'd you break a bone? In your knee. How horrible was the pain? It hurt. It was hell. What about you, Mom?
Wow, foot.
Broke your foot. How horrible was that?
Real hard.
It was hell. Now, imagine all of that being broken at once. While some cracker is standing over you saying, do you accept the love of Jesus in your life? Do you accept the Holy Trinity of Mother Mary and Jesus and the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit? Well, that's what was going on during the Spanish Inquisition, all right? It says, bound, the heretic could then be subjected to other forms of torture for the exaltation of their faith. Now, has anybody ever seen the movie Braveheart? With what's the white boy, Mel Gibson. Y'all remember at the end, that torture they put him through? Well, that was common during the time of the Spanish Inquisition. Now, it's another thing y'all might not know. William Wallace was a black man. That time period in history, with the Scottish fighting against the English, those were black people in Scotland at that time. Those were Jews in Scotland at that time who refused to bow down to the religious leadership in Europe, and they refused to bow down to the monarchy. Them people that was fighting against the English back in the 1200s and the 1300s, those were black people. There's a book we have. You can get it online. It's called When Scotland Was Jewish. And it talks all about when black people was living in Scotland, ruling in Scotland. So the torture that you saw play out in the movie Braveheart is similar to what we're reading about now. All right. I'm going to read about some more. It says the stocks. Now, y'all see the picture of the rack, right? It's a big ass table. The head would be here with the arms tied above. The feet would be down there. They got these damn spikes. They would put in different parts of the body. As the man cranked this, the arms and the legs were separated from the body, all right? It says the rack was extensively used during the Spanish Inquisition, all right? Boom. It says the stocks, with their feet in the stocks, two pieces of timber clamped together, over and under, both across each leg above the ankles. Everybody see that, right? See the man's feet is in there. Boom, the wood is above and below his, the wood is squeezing his ankles together. So he can't move out of the stocks. It says, being more painful but less fatal than racking, this was the torture most in vogue when the subject chanced to be of the female sex. So if they was torturing the female, they showed a little bit of pity. Instead of putting her on the rack, they put her in the stocks. It says, it was also favored in cases where children were to be persuaded to testify against their parents. These crackers was taking kids and torturing the kids to get them to confess against their parents. It says slighter tortures consisted of binding a piece of iron to a limb and putting a twister mark to force it inwards, as was pressing the fingers with rods between them or removing a nail from fingers or toes, which were all highly practiced upon persons of not sufficient strength to support the pulley rack or fire. So meaning this person was too weak or too young to deal with the severe torture of the rack, they put them in the stocks and pulled their nails off their toes. Or they put little iron bars in between the toes and cranked the iron bar so that it forced the toes to break. Or they put a nail up against the bone of the foot and would screw the nail into the foot. This is how the white man tortured people in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Everybody understand? Here's water torture. Now, what we about to read about has never gone away. Now, a lot of this torture did not end with the Spanish Inquisition. A lot of these methods of torture are still around today, and you hear them talking about it on TV when it comes to how the white man deals with terrorist captives or prisoners of war that they dealing with over there with the Arabs in the Middle East. Come on with
Slock, sir. Have you ever heard of like the is a way that the Moabites that they torture like prisoners of war when they catch them and they like put them in a tub or something and they just like they lay them down, mm-hmm. They knock them out, I guess, and they just turn a faucet on.
I just drip the water.
Yeah,
boop, boop. Yeah, it just drives them crazy. Yeah, I've heard about that. That's not as terrible as with the white man, but we about to read about now. All right. It says water torture. The victim's nostrils were pinched shut, and 8 quarts of fluid were poured down the victim's throat through a funnel. Other techniques, including forcing a cloth down the throat while pouring water, which made a swallowing reflex, pushing it further down into the stomach, producing all of the agonies of suffocation by drowning until the victim lost consciousness. Instead of water, The torture was sometimes conducted with boiling water or vinegar. Now, has anybody ever heard of waterboarding? It's a term that you hear on the news today. That's how the white man tortures the Arabs today. They find Muslims and they want to torture them to find out who's the next suicide bomber, where y'all hiding, what cave y'all hiding in. They waterboard. Waterboarding is when you tie a towel around a man's face. You have him in restraints, you lay him back, and you pour water down his nose and down his throat. You understand? They tie the towel around so that you can't close your mouth, can't close your nose, and they force water down your mouth and down your throat. And has anybody ever accidentally inhaled water in their nose? How horrible is that? You accidentally breathe in water and it's it go in your lungs, you like you're coughing. Well, imagine that for 3 minutes. Imagine somebody pouring water down your nose into your lungs and your stomach and your chest, and there's nothing you can do to fight against it. How much of that you gonna take before you accept white Jesus? How much of that you gonna take before you ride on whoever the white man is asking you to ride on? Well, our brothers and sisters during the time of the Spanish Inquisition had to endure this, not to rap. Had to endure this to hold on to the truth of the Most High. Everybody understand? You read in the book of Maccabees, 2 Maccabees, the 7th chapter, you read about that mother and her sons that died and was murdered to not eat pork. But this is something our people have always suffered and dealt with under the hands of the white man. Everybody understand? There's another one. It says the heretic's fork. This instrument consisted of two little forks, one set against the other. You can see the picture here. Y'all see the two forks, right? It's a fork pressing down on the chest, a fork under the chin. It says, with the four prongs plunged into the flesh under the chin and above the chest, with hands secured firmly behind their backs. So the person's hand behind their back, they stick this fork under your chin into your chest. It says a small collar supported the instrument in such a manner that the victims were usually forced to hold their head erect, thus preventing any movement. This is something that just forced your neck to be stuck in one position. It said the forks did not penetrate vital points, and thus suffering was prolonged and death was always nearly avoided. The pointed prongs on each end to crane the person's head made speech or movement impossible. The heretic's fork was very common during the height of the Spanish Inquisition. Here's another torture tool, the pear. The pear was a torture device used on females. This device was inserted into the vagina or mouth of the victim and then expanded by force of the screw to the maximum aperture setting of the victim's cavity. The antrum would then irremediably become lacerated, nearly always fatal, ripping the tissue, flesh, and membranes. Now, that's horrible. Everybody understand? This is the pear. When it was closed, they would put it inside a woman and then crank it till it opened. And as they crank it, it's going to split the woman to where she can't never heal and she'll just bleed forever and die. I'm out.
It's like,
I'm
doing what on period of on time was this on going on?
Stop the Spanish Inquisition was between 1468 and 18, let me pull it up, hold up. Spanish Inquisition was 1478 to 1834. This was occurring during the time of the Renaissance era, when the white man was coming out of power and was coming back into power in Europe. He established the Spanish Inquisition to target Jews and Muslims. We all know that the Jews and Muslims in Europe during this time was Israelites or dark-skinned people. Now, some of the Muslims could have been Israelites, could have been other nations. But we know that Europe was all black at one time. It was the Dark Ages. Well, after the Dark Ages, this is how the white man came back to power. Spanish Inquisition, once they said you were a heretic or you taught something against the Catholic Church, that was it. They tortured you till you died. And this thing was systematic in the destruction of our culture and our civilization in Europe during the time of the Dark Ages. Coming out of the Dark Ages, this is how the white man got rid of our people. Wiped out all memory of our existence in that land. Everybody understand? Come on with it.
Y'all seen the movie Hostel?
Yeah.
That like I wouldn't never go to Europe.
Yeah, well, I would never go to Europe neither, and I didn't have to see the hostel to realize that. Yeah, but whatever it is to make you realize the white man is the devil, Baraka thought y'all while y'all was shot. You understand? Right. You gonna say something, sis?
Yeah, they still use the same device on females.
They do? That's the device they use to do the female exams?
Yeah.
Well, now you see how evil the white man is? Like, how you think he learned how to use that device? He then tortured so many women with it, he decided, well, let's use it, you know, for the medicine. That's horrible. Well, next time you go to the doctor, just, you know, say a prayer, Salagi. Don't let him put you to sleep, you know what I mean, and say a prayer. But that white man used that to torture our sisters with. Everybody understand? Here's another thing. He said the Brinks. The Brinks, also sometimes called Dame's Bridle or Skull's Bridle, comprised of a metal facial mask and spiked mouth depressor that was implemented on housewives up until the early 19th century. Many clergymen sustained in his husband's right to handle his wife and use salutary restraints in every case of misbehavior. Without the intervention of what some court records of 1824 refer to as vexatious prosecutions. Okay, now, this is horrible. Black woman, don't you ever say nothing about the black man being mean or cruel or horrible to you ever. This is what the white man used when his woman would not shut her mouth. Does everybody see this thing? Okay, it's a metal helmet, right? The head goes in a helmet, but the helmet has a mouthpiece on it. The woman would put her head inside the helmet and the mouthpiece would go in her mouth. And it would keep her from talking. That's how the white man shut his woman up. Well, white women, now you want to know why white women are so kind. And white women do whatever you tell her to do, because they was tortured to death with this thing here. You understand? White man is disgusting and evil. That is called the Brinks or the Dame's Bridle. That's all. All right, we're going to get into a couple more of these, and we're going to go to the scriptures. It says the wheel. The wheel was one of the most popular and insidious methods of torture and execution practice. The giant spiked wheel was able to break bodies as it rolled forward, causing the most agonizing and drawn-out death. Other forms include the braided wheel, where the victim would be tied to the execution dock or platform. Their limbs were spread and tied to stakes or iron rings on the ground. Slices of wood were placed under the main joints, wrist, ankles, knees, hips, and elbows. The executioner would then smash every joint with the iron tired edge of the wheel. However, the executioner would avoid fatal blows to give the victim a painful death. Who would think of some shit like that? Did y'all understand what I just read? He put the person on the wheel. You see the wheel, right? They would put the person on the wheel. And as the wheel rolled, of course, as the wheel rolled, your bones would break and you'd be jammed up. But if they wanted to really torture you, they would put wood along the wheel underneath all of your major joints, underneath your elbows, your shoulders, your hips, your knees, and your ankles. And they would, as they rolled, now, you take a piece of wood and you put it against a metal wheel, and you try to bend that piece of wood, what's going to happen? It's a straight piece of wood. You lay it flat on the wheel and roll the wheel over, what's going to happen to the wood? Marat.
Right, going to break.
It's going to break. But what happens to the wood when it breaks underneath your kneecap? Marat.
It's going to stab you.
It's, okay, don't think stab. You think it's going to pop your knee out of place. Right. Imagine you got a splint on your leg. Like, they take some wood and tie your leg to the wood. Well, if they bend the wood till it snaps and your leg is still tied to it, when the wood snaps, it's going to snap your leg too. Well, they would do that to every piece of your body and had it in a way where you wouldn't die. You would just feel the pain and suffer through the pain, and it'd be hell and horrible. Now, all of this torture the white man did, he did it in front of people. He did it in the town square. I showed the picture up here where they're doing the torture in front of everybody. This is the town square. This is people being hung and tortured and murdered and burnt and all type of evil. Well, what's going on around them? People are watching this shit. The people are seeing what's going on. So for every person that does not want to accept white baby Jesus and Virgin Mary and the rest of the Catholic nonsense and, you know, priest penis in their baby mouth, what, how many of these people got to go through what they're going through before the people out here just say, man, fuck that. I'll accept white Jesus. I'll accept Mother Mary and Catholic priest. You can have my son. Take him. Let him be an altar boy. Well, that's how our people became Christian. When you hear, when you read stories about Christopher Columbus coming over to America and the population of the Native Indians being wiped out, well, this is why. Because the white man did this shit for fun. He did this for shits and giggles. This is how, you know, this was Friday afternoon for him. Well, our people suffered and endured this to the point to where there was almost none of us left. This happened to us in North America, South America, Central America, in the Caribbean islands. That is why, this is why today they got a giant statue of Jesus in Brazil. This is why today the Mexicans and the Puerto Ricans and the Dominicans love Santa Maria. They love Mary. They never gonna give up their candles of white Jesus and Jesus Cristo, Jesus Blanco, and all of that BS. Everybody understand? This is how you get a people to convert. This is how you get a people to accept your religion. The reason why I showed you this is because the Spanish Inquisition has never ended. The Spanish Inquisition today is the FBI, is the CIA. It is the SWAT. It is the U.S. Marshals coming in and rounding you up. It is the bounty hunters coming to serve a warrant on you. You understand? The policy that the white man instituted of finding heretics, breaking down their doors and torturing them to put fear in everybody else has never gone away. That is the torture that we're suffering today here in this land called America under the hands of the so-called white man. You want to say something?
Kind of, I seen the movie like that.
What movie?
I don't know how to pronounce it, but it's spelled H-U-E-Y or something like that.
Okay.
It's about how the Spaniards came to the Americas and the Native Americans were there, and they asked them to. Then they asked them, they like demanded them that they would accept their queen or their king, stuff like that. And then the chief said no. He said, "What if we don't want to?" And he said, and the Spaniards said that we're gonna make her a slave. We're gonna make sure that we do anything possible to make it a little bit hell for you.
Mm-hmm.
So the Spaniards made them look for gold.
Mm-hmm.
They couldn't get enough gold, so they would get their hands cut off.
Listen, that's the white man. You understand? That is the white man. If you ever want to know about why our people are so diehard Christians today, all you got to do is go back and research Spanish Inquisition. Research torture tactics of the Catholic Church. I'm going to play a video once we go through some scriptures, but I want to get some scriptures on it, all right? I gave you Jeremiah 49:16. The Lord said the terribleness of the white man had deceived him. The white man believes in his heart of hearts that because of all of the fear that he struck into the hearts and minds of people throughout this planet, that no one is ever going to come against him. No one is ever going to be able to stand up to him. All right. Give me Revelation 17:6.
Hello, welcome.
Revelation 17:6. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Yahushua. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration.
Who is this woman in Revelation the 17th chapter? You read verse 5. It is the whore that sitteth upon many waters. It is Mystery Babylon the Great. Who is this woman that has the blood of the martyrs of Christ, the blood of the saints? I'm a
white man.
It's the white man. It's the Roman Catholic Church. Everybody understand? It's the CIA, the FBI, every institution that the white man has utilized to torture and murder and rape and rob on this earth. That is the whore that sitteth on many waters. Everybody understand? That is Mystery Babylon. And the blood of our people is all over the white man. All throughout the Spanish Inquisition, the target was us. Everybody understand? Give me Revelation 18 and 24. Read on, start 21.
Come on. We are on Revelations 18, verse 21. And a mighty angel took up a stone, like a great millstone, and cast it into the sea, saying, thus with violence shall the great city Babylon be thrown down, and shall be found no more at all.
You understand? The Lord prophesied the destruction of the white man. Same way that look when that angel took the stone and threw it into the water and all of that, the great wave that was made from that stone being thrown in the water. That's the same way the Lord is going to wipe out the white man. That's the same way the Lord is going to get vengeance and justice for our people for all the evil the white man has done. The same way that stone flying into the sea caused a great wave and destruction and trouble in the water. That's how the Lord is going to deal with the white man. That's how he's going to destroy the city of Babylon. You understand? With that same type of violence, the white man is going to be destroyed and be found no more. Read on.
Verse 22. And the voice of the harpers and musicians and the pipers and trumpeters shall be heard no more at all in thee.
Ain't going to be no more singing, no more dancing, no more entertainment, no more Hollywood. Read on.
And no craftsman or whatsoever craft he be shall be found any more in thee.
You understand? No more bankers, no more, the military designers making boats and planes and drones with drop bombs out the sky. All of that's going to be wiped out. Read on.
And the sound of a millstone shall be heard no more at all in thee.
The sound of destruction, the sound of death. You understand? That millstone was hung around a person's neck before they was thrown into the water, thrown into the sea to drown. Everybody understand? Well, the sound of our death and destruction is no more going to be found in the hands of the white man. Read on.
Verse 23. And the light of a candle shall shine no more at all in thee.
No more light. Read on.
And the voice of the
bridegroom.
The voice of the bridegroom. And of the bride shall be heard no more at all.
No more happiness and marriage and sex and wild fun. Read on.
For thy merchants were the great men of the earth.
All of the men that helped make this place rich. You understand? America has gotten rich with all the merchants of the earth. Read on.
For by thy sorceries were all nations deceived.
What are the sorceries of the white man? All of his indoctrination, all of his lying, all of his all of his advertising. You understand? All of his everything he puts into your mind to make you believe that America is great and the white man is amazing and great and you should try to be like him. All of his sorceries is what he has used to deceive all nations. Everybody understand? Read on.
Verse 24. And in her was found the blood of the prophets and of saints and of all that were slain upon the earth.
More importantly, the Lord sees that the blood of the prophets and of the saints are in this white man. You understand? He is the chief shedder of all of our blood. He is the chief murderer of our people. He is the chief of all of our destruction and sadness and turmoil and torture that we've endured for the past 500 plus years. Everybody understand? Give me Obadiah chapter 10, verse 10. And then I'll get off of it. You understand? I mean, I'll play this video and then we'll go into the next topic. Anybody have any questions? Ahmad, I know you wanted to, you still wanted the 12 tribes, right? I'm going to start. You know, I'm going to be the finish. That breakdown is damn near two classes long. So
yeah,
I'll start tonight and then we'll finish it next week. All right. All right. Let me get Obadiah verse 10.
Obadiah chapter 10. I mean, Selaka, verse 10. Selaka, Obadiah chapter 1, verse 10. For thy violence against thy brother Jacob, shame shall cover thee.
Why does the Lord hate the white man? Because of his violence against us. Everybody understand? Because of the murder and the blood and the killing that he's brought down on our people. The Lord said, for thy violence against thy brother Jacob, shame shall cover thee. How do you shame the white man today? Hey, Ma.
Just like how we do, we go out there and teach how evil he is.
We go out there and show everybody how evil the white man is. That's how you shame white people. You know what a white man hates more than anything? Is you showing him to his face that he is the same murderer, rapist, robber that his ancestors were. White people today, they know that everything they have, they owe to this. You understand? They know that very clearly. But they like to try and live in their minds like they're okay. Like they're good people. Yeah, there was a lot of raping and murdering and robbing, but I'm different. We're different now. We've grown. White people today would like to think that they're better than their ancestors. You know what makes them realize that they're not? When we show them what their ancestors have done and they feel nothing because of it. When we hold up that sign that shows all the babies that was hung, you think white people give a fuck about that? Salaka, excuse my French. You think them crackers care? Them crackers, when they see it, they feel nothing. That's what makes them mad. When you talk about the Spanish Inquisition and show the torture, the white man feels nothing. That's what shames him. Because showing him the handiwork of his fathers that has allowed him to have what he has today, white people know when they see it, so what? Who gives a fuck? I got Starbucks. I got, you know, Xbox and PlayStation. I don't give a damn what happened to you niggas. It's better you than me. That's what makes white people mad. This, when we out there speaking, the signs about abortion and about the hanging is not what makes white people mad. What makes white people mad is them feeling inside of themselves that I don't care about none of this shit. That's what makes them mad. Because every evil person would like to think in their mind that I ain't as, at least I'm like, okay, before in the world, you knew a cat that was doing something evil. That's, you know, he'd talk about it like, yeah, but I ain't as bad as so-and-so that, you know, rape kids. But it's like, you know, dude, you putting pills in these broads' drinks to get them to have sex with you. Like, you was a rapist. Yeah, but you know, I ain't raping them. Like, what you mean? Doc, you raping them. A cat that sold crack is like, yeah, but you know, I don't sell to my man's moms and them. Whoever you selling crack to is somebody's moms. Just because you ain't selling to this nigga's mother don't make you better. You feel what I'm saying? Evil people need someone that's more evil to them to feel justified. Well, white people today feel justified because at least I'm not as evil as my ancestors. But when they think I'm not as evil as my ancestors. But when you show them pictures of what their ancestors have done and they feel nothing, they know in their minds, I'm just as evil as my ancestors. That's what makes them mad. Y'all see what I'm saying? Like, they not mad at what their ancestors did. They mad that they don't give a fuck about it, which makes them know, wait, I'm really just as bad as my ancestors because I don't care about these niggas. That's what makes white people mad. That is the shame that the Lord said was going to cover the white man for his violence against Jacob. Everybody clear? Read on.
And thou shalt be cut off forever.
And because of it, the Lord said the white man is going to be cut off forever. What does it mean to be cut off forever? The Lord is going to destroy white people. We are going to enslave white people. We are going to torture and kill and destroy them to the point where there's none of them left. You everybody understand? There's a blessing that the Lord put on the children of Israel to be able to make children the way that we make children. I want y'all to understand that. No people on the earth makes babies the way we make babies. Most people in slavery and being tortured and tormented, they can't find time for sex. They can't find time to make babies. Black people, no matter what you do, we going to make babies. Everybody understand? And brothers and sisters in the Caribbean, them just Puerto Ricans and Dominicans, no matter what hell you put them through, they is going to find time to make babies. The white man cannot live like that.
Right.
You understand? He barely making babies as it is. Imagine him trying to make babies when he's tortured all day and in slavery and picking cotton and cutting down trees and, you know, I'm gonna have white people do the most menial, ridiculous tasks in the earth. You understand? You gotta. I'm gonna have a field, and it's gonna be the white man's job that no water touches this field. Well, every morning when the sun rises, dew is gonna be on the ground, right? Well, it's gonna be lashes for every drop of water that's on this field in the morning. It's perpetual torture for the white man because he's never gonna be able to stop dew from forming. That's the type of jobs I'm giving crackers in the kingdom if I make it to lock. If I see a drop, I'm gonna come out every morning at 5:59, right before the sunrise. I see a drop of water out here. It's 50 lashes. They're going to be in hell. You understand? But because they deserve it for the evil that they've done to our people. The Lord said they are going to be cut off forever. They ain't going to have time to make babies. Everybody understand? Eventually, white people are going to be wiped off of the face of the earth. Give me Ezekiel 5. Ezekiel 35. Salah. You had something you wanted to bring out, Mara?
Yeah, that was funny what you were saying about how the drug dealers is. Every drug that I talk to, he always say, "Well, you racist." Like they just like the drug.
Yeah, like that shit is crazy. Salaki, I mind if I could, right? I'm gonna do the 12 tribes breakdown next week, just so we can get it clear.
Yeah.
Try to run through it in the 2 hours that we have for class, and I'm gonna keep on this, all right? Because from the torture, I'm just gonna go into all of the evil white man scriptures. Everybody understand? All right, come on, Sean Mar.
Ezekiel, the 35th chapter, what verse?
Verse 5.
Ezekiel, chapter 35, verse 5. Because thou hast had a perpetual hatred.
Salaki, do me a favor. Go to verse 3. Or verse 2. Start at verse 2 now. For anyone that says we can't hate all white people ain't bad. Remember these scriptures. Remember what we learned in class tonight. Remember the Spanish Inquisition. Next time, and the reason why I teach this class this way is because I want all of you all to be equipped with the necessary history background to be able to show these crackers that they are the evilest, most diabolical bastards that have ever lived on the face of this planet. And all of the death and destruction that the Lord brings on them, they deserve it. Everybody understand? Sometimes being in America, being in the truth, you tend to feel sometimes like, damn, we kind of hard on white people. And I do it more so because myself sometimes, I'd be like, man, that's kind of cruel. You know what I mean? We be saying some hurtful things to white people. And sometimes you might be like, well, damn, B, they just, you know. But when you go into history and you see how evil they have been, and you see how much of what they've done in history is the same exact thing as what they're doing today, it takes all of that, damn, we a little hard away. Everybody understands? The Lord's punishment that's prophesied in the Bible for this devil is very well deserved. He has earned every bit of death that he is going to receive when Christ returns. Everybody understand? These scriptures is the evidence. The history is the evidence. Anytime a cracker come to you and say anything about, come on, man, can't we just be love or peace and just bring up the Spanish Inquisition. Bring up slavery first. Right? Say, come on, man, slavery was a long time ago. Bring up the Spanish Inquisition. Go into that. They say, well, come on, man. Talk about CIA and Ronald Reagan. Everybody understand? Talk about the Iran-Contra scandal. Everything I teach in this class is to equip you to be able to destroy anyone that tries to come up against the truth. Everybody understand? All right, so read Ezekiel 35, verse 2.
Ezekiel chapter 35, and verse 2. Son of man, set thy face against the Mount Seir. And prophesy against it.
What is Mount Seir? Mount Seir is the homeland, the origin of the so-called white man in the Middle East. Mount Seir is where the land of Edom is today. Today, the land of Edom is slightly south of where, Jordan is, right before you get into the Arabian Peninsula. Everybody understand? The Lord said, turn your face to Mount Seir and prophesy against it. Mount Seir today is not the land. This prophecy is not to the land. It's to everywhere white people are living. It's everywhere where the Edomites dwell. Everybody understand? Read on.
Verse 3. And say unto it, thus saith the Most High Power, behold, O Mount Seir, I am against thee.
The Lord said he's against the white man. Read on.
And I will stretch out mine hand against thee.
The Lord said he's going to stretch his hand out against The white man, read on.
And I will make the most desolate.
He gonna make the most desolate, most destroyed. Read on.
Verse 4. I will lay thy cities waste, and thou shalt be desolate, and thou shalt know that I am Yahweh.
You understand? The most I said, you're gonna know that I am Yahweh. You understand? If you're reading it in the Bible, the am might be italicized, right? Meaning it's slightly, this text look like it's slightly shifted, right? When you read that, it's to give you a sign of influx on that am. You understand? It's like the Lord is saying, you're going to know that I am the Lord. You understand? Why? Because the white man thinks that he's the Lord. He thinks that he's the Most High. He thinks that he's the power that rules on this earth. The Lord said, in the day when I destroy you, you're going to know that I am the Most High. Everybody understand? Read on.
Verse 5, because thou hast had a perpetual hatred and hast shed the blood of the children of Israel by the force of the sword, the time of their calamity.
And why does the Lord hate the white man? Why is he going to destroy Mount Seir and make it most desolately? Because the white man has had a perpetual hatred and has shed the blood of the children of Israel by the force of the sword in the time of their calamity. In the time when the Lord wanted to punish us, wanted to deal with us for our evil, the white man came along and said, here's a time for blood. Here's a time to get my hands dirty. Here's a time to come up with some ways to take a life. The white man has literally experimented on how to take a life, how to push the human body to its limits by dealing with black people. Slavery, the Spanish Inquisition, that thing y'all told me about, that tool they still use today, it take me back to when I studied the medical profession. The white man learned everything from experimenting on black people. He experimented on black women to find out the different tests and the different things that they do today. A lot of sisters died and had parts of their bodies gouged and prodded and plucked and electrocuted and had all manner of evil done to them so that the white man could learn how to be a doctor, learn how to be a, you know, a gynecologist and all of the other evil. Now, I mean, today, you got to get it checked out, make sure everything is working right, because we ain't got, you know, sisters that's doing it. But before the time when the white man knew what he was doing, he was just down there playing around. And a lot of sisters suffered and had horrible things happen because the white man trying to study how the human body works. Everybody understand? Lord said he had a perpetual hatred. Perpetual is never ending, forever lasting. That's how white people hate you. That's why when we go at camp and we shame the white man, that's where that anger comes from, them knowing that they hate us, from them knowing that they feel the same exact way that their ancestors who murdered us and raped us openly felt. Everybody understand? The Lord said, because of their perpetual hatred, because they shed our blood in the time of our calamity, read on, verse 6.
In the time that their iniquity had an end, verse 6, therefore, as I live, saith the Most High Power, I will prepare thee unto blood, and blood shall pursue thee.
Lord said, therefore, as I live, what the Most High saying? That this thing is going as like how black people talk, on my mama. You understand? The Lord is saying, on my mama, as I live, saith the Most High. Read on. Read, I will prepare thee.
I will prepare thee unto blood, and blood shall pursue thee.
The Most High said, as I live, I'm going to make sure that blood catch up to you, white man. As I live, all that blood that you shed, that you love to get your hands dirty in, I'm going to make you swim in it. I'm going to bring it down on your head. I'm going to drown you in the blood. Because you don't hate blood, you love blood. But you love blood so much, Mr. White Man, I'm going to make you drink it. I'm going to make you feel it and see what it's like to have the streets filled with the blood of your children, of your wives, of your sons, of your strong men. Everybody understand? Read on.
Say, if thou hast not hated blood, even blood shall pursue thee.
Seeing as though you don't hate blood, blood is going to pursue you. Now I'm going to play this video, right? The video says, the crimes of the Catholic Church, number one, all right? I'm going to play it, and then come back, we're gonna get some more scriptures, all right?
Another
one coming. All right. Let me get the speaker, because I don't know if the brothers and sisters online will be able to hear. It's kind of loud, though. Yeah, yeah, I need to speak. Y'all won't be able to hear. Had it right here. No sweat.
Somebody, you want some coffee?
No, I'm too wild, boy. Too wild. Appreciate it, buddy. All right.
The Inquisition, run by the Catholic Church, is evidence that shows how corrupt and cruel the Catholic Church is. The Inquisition, which was established for religious trials, became a transnational institution of the Catholic Church. It was devised to condemn heretics designated by the Catholic Church. Heretics defined by the Catholic Church were the Christians who opposed the false insistence and doctrines of the Pope and wanted to live by the Bible.
Now, y'all hear that? The heretics were the people that did not want to do what the Pope said, but wanted to live according to the Bible. Well, who are the only people on the earth that live according to the Bible? What do we call it today? Marah.
The Israelites.
The Israelites, but particularly what Israelites are the ones that want to live according to the Bible? Marah.
Christians?
No. Christians, do they live according to the Bible?
No.
Marah. I mean, Sharma.
You said what Israelites want to live according to the Bible?
What Israelites want to live according to the Bible, not what some religious leaders say? What do we call them people today?
Jews.
No. Marah.
People in the truth.
Brothers in the truth. We the only ones that want to live according to the Bible. Well, during the time of Europe in the Middle Ages, there was people that didn't want to live to what the Pope said. They didn't want to believe whatever the white man said. They wanted to just believe in the Bible. Well, the Spanish Inquisition was set up for them. The same people today that wanted to believe in the Bible, the brothers and sisters in the truth, are the same ones who the Spanish Inquisition was trying to weed out during the time of the Middle Ages. Everybody understand?
Rule over the world as they want. The popes tried to get rid of the Bible and restricted people from reading it.
Who today wants to get rid of the Bible and stop people from reading it? Sharma.
They did something like that like the Moabites did it. They did something like that in their country too.
Come, but they, we shouldn't care. We don't care about the Moabites because it ain't dealing with Israel. We dealing with us. You understand? The white man now, today, who doesn't want you to read the Bible? Aymar.
Yeah, white man.
The white man. Who else? Aymar.
The Roman Catholic Church.
The Roman Catholic Church. Who among Israelites don't want you to read the Bible? Aymar. The Christian, yeah, the Christian leader, the pastor, the cat running for the governor and the mayor. They don't want you reading the Bible because reading the Bible is going to let you know to go against them. Everybody understand?
Pope Alexander III labeled those who read the Bible as heretics and commanded to confine Christians who were condemned as heretics to expropriate their property.
What does it mean to expropriate your property? Meaning they take your property. So during the time when the Inquisition started, the main purpose was to take people's property. When you take someone's property, what do you become? You take enough people's property, what's going to eventually happen? You're going to be rich. If I find, you know, five heretics that all got $50,000 in the bank, and I say, you don't believe in the Pope, and I throw them in jail and take their property, then that $50,000 belongs to me now. If I do that to enough people, then I'll be a millionaire. That's what the white man did under the Inquisition. Everybody understand? You gonna say something, Ma?
Yeah, tell them. Can I just don't have own question? So, who own property was they on taking at this time?
The people who they deemed was heretics. The people who wanted to read the Bible. The people who didn't want to believe in the Pope. The people that have always wanted to read the Bible and not do what man said to do. The followers of Christ, the disciples, who we know have always been Israelites. Everybody understand?
Pope Innocent III instituted the Inquisition and launched crusades to combat heresy. Numerous Christians were killed and dispossessed of their properties.
Now, the crusades was a time and during this time in Europe, when the white man who was a Roman went to war in the Middle East against Muslims, against Israelites, against anybody who stood against the Roman church. Everybody understand? It was many wars that was fought. It's very much like what is going on today with the white man fighting in the Middle East. Even though they're not saying it publicly, what's going on in the Middle East is a war between Christians and Muslims. It is just like the Crusades of the Middle Ages of between, you know, 1000 AD and 1800s. You understand? The Crusades started because of the wealth the Roman Catholic Church was able to gain because of the Inquisition.
Pope Gregory the Ninth claimed to punish heretics who did not repent and appointed the order of Saint Dominic as the Inquisitor.
Saint Dominic is where Dominicans come from. Saint Dominic was in charge of the order of the Inquisitor, or the order of torturers. You understand? Saint Dominic was in charge of all of the men whose job it was to torture Israelites, to force them to convert to Catholicism, or to throw them in jail and take their property. Everybody understand? So that name, Dominican or Dominic, comes from an evil bastard during the Roman Empire. Everybody understand?
Pope Innocent IV promulgated the bull Ad Extirpanda, explicitly authorizing torture, and commanded to burn everyone who opposed Catholicism. Here is the salient religious trial of the century. Giordano Bruno, a medieval astronomer, was charged as a heretic by the Catholic Church and burned at the stake. The reason he was burned was that he denied the geocentric theory and insisted on the heliocentric theory. After that, Galileo verified that the Earth revolves around the Sun. But he too was declared a heretic and was forced to recant his heliocentric view. Joan of Arc, Maid of Orleans, who saved France from a crisis, was burned at the stake as a witch by the Inquisition. As years went by, the Inquisition helped the Pope exercise his extraterritoriality. To stay in power, the Catholic Church accused those who stood against them of being heretics and eliminated them. If a person was charged of being a heretic once, he had no right to have counsel. He was severely tortured and ended up being imprisoned for life or executed by fire. The Inquisition was the most infamous and devilish thing in human history. It was devised by the popes and used by them for 500 years to maintain their power. For its record, none of the subsequent lines of holy and invaluable popes have ever apologized. He was given power to make war against the saints and to conquer them.
They go into the scripture before that scripture. I want y'all to read. I want y'all to hear this next part, though. It says, historians estimate that in the Middle Ages and early Reformation era, more than 50 million martyrs perished at the hands of the papacy. That means they killed over 50 million people in Europe during the time of the Middle Ages. Now, add that on top of how many Native Indians died when the white man came to America. 77 million died. How many so-called Negroes died in the transatlantic slave trade just making the boat trip to America? 99 million. Let me get that. On top of the 77 million Native Indians, on top of the 99 million Negroes that perished during the transatlantic slave trade, another 50 million was murdered in Europe at the hands of the white man under the Inquisition. Everybody understand? Read on some more. Now, again, in another time period of history after the Middle
Ages, the papacy. During the Dark Ages, 50 million innocent people were killed.
During the Dark Ages, which is another time period in Europe, another 50 million martyrs were killed. Everybody understand? This is the blood that the Lord is talking about in Ezekiel 35. You understand? All of the murder and the rape and the robbery that the white man has done goes beyond what he did here in America. Goes beyond what he did in the Caribbean and in South America. It goes all the way back to the time when we were in Europe. Everybody understand? 100 million people were killed at the hands of the Pope and the Roman Catholic Church between the 1,000 years from 1000 AD to the 1800s when, you know what I'm saying, when white man started to come over here and colonize America. Come on, you gonna say something?
They still do that in Europe?
Still do what? The Inquisition? Okay. No. They don't do it the way they did it before. It's not as open as it is. But the policy of rounding up people who don't believe the way that the white man says they should believe and murdering them and torturing them and killing them and terrorizing them still goes on every day in America, in Europe. If you Black, Hispanic, and Native Indian, the Inquisition has never really stopped. Because if you don't believe what the white man says you're supposed to believe, the white man targets you. We've seen it happen with our people forever in this land called America. The Black Panthers, the Muslims in Islam, the so-called Moors nation. The only difference between everybody else and the men of the Lord today is that we follow the truth. We follow the Lord. We got the spirit of Yahushua, and they didn't. You understand? Black people are still suffering and dying. This, the death that we was dying in Europe, the death we died during slavery, is no different than the death that we die today in America. The police killing us, shooting us down in the street. Brothers still getting hung down in the southern states. Ain't nothing changed. The white man still murdering us down in Mexico and Colombia and Brazil. The slavery and the death and the murder and the torture has never ended for our people. It just changed. The name that they called it became different. Instead of it being the, you know, the Inquisitors of Saint Dominic, Dominic, now you got the FBI. Now you got the CIA, you got the United Nations. Everybody understand? It's never stopped. It just changed the way it looks. All right? Let me get Isaiah chapter 32, verse 6. I wanted to play that clip especially because it showed that all of this murder the white man was doing was because of a religious belief, right? Well, who is the earth against today because of their murdering and killing for a religious belief? Who's everybody against? Who's everybody saying is wrong and evil when you turn on the TV because of how they killing for their religion? It's the Muslims, ISIS. They terrorists and they killing people because of their belief. Well, was what ISIS doing anything different than what the white man did? ISIS ain't got nothing on the Catholic Church. 50 million people in the Middle Ages, 50 million people in the Dark Ages. That's 100 million people the Catholic Church murdered in Europe. That's only in Europe. That's not talking about what they did to Africa when they got there and killed them Africans. That's not talking about what they did to the Native Indians when they came here to America and in the Caribbean and in South America. It's not talking about what they did to us when they tried to force us to accept Christianity. The blood that the white man has spilled is far exceeded anything that any other race could have imagined to do on this planet. No one has come close to murdering and slaughtering and torturing and enslaving like the white man has done. Now, have other nations killed? Have other nations tortured and enslaved? Yes, everybody on the planet has killed and tortured and enslaved at some point in their history, but no one has done it anywhere near close to what the white man did. Does everybody understand? Give me Isaiah chapter 32, verse 6. You understand? Now I'll read verse 5. So lucky.
It's
lucky,
so I got it.
Come on.
Isaiah chapter 32, verse 5.
Actually, Salaki, if I could. Go up to verse 2.
Isaiah chapter 32.
This is the time that we're living in today. This time that the Lord is speaking about in Isaiah 32 is the time that we are in today. the time that is on us now. Read on.
Isaiah chapter 32, verse 2. And a man shall be as in hiding place from the wind.
What does that mean? Read on. Read on.
And a covert. In a covert from the tempest.
What does it mean? And a man shall be as a hiding place from the wind. When it's real windy out now, don't think of a regular wind. Think of tornado winds. When it's a tornado outside, what do you need the most? Sis, Naima. Huh? Somewhere to go. Somewhere would you like to go when it's a tornado? You want to go to the park? Where would you like to go when it's a tornado outside? Other sis.
Underground.
Underground. Somewhere where the wind can't get you. But a man is like that today. A man in the UPK is like a, what'd you say again? Underground? A man today that stands for the Lord is like having an underground bunker when it's a tornado outside. That's a place where you can go to be protected. You got a man that's in the truth. If you are a man in the truth, you are a fortress. You understand? You are a place to hide when the tornado winds is tearing everything down. You are a covert place from the tempest. The tempest is the storm. You a place to hide when the storm comes through, when the hurricane swing through. Everybody understand? Read on.
As rivers of water in a dry
like place. A river that just come out of the middle of the desert. That's what a man is like. You understand? This scripture is a precept for that when the Lord said, I will make a man as fine gold of Ophir. Everybody understand? This is what a man is today. This is the value of a man. You like a river flowing in the desert. You in the desert walking for days and miles and the heat get hot and your lips look like Clint Eastwood and good, bad, and ugly. You want to find a river. You understand? Well, that's what a man is like, a river in the desert. Read on.
As the shadow of a great rock in a weary land.
As the shadow of a great rock in the land when the sun just beating down on everybody. The sun is just draining everybody of the energy. A man is like finding that shade. Everybody understand? Read on.
Verse 3, and the eyes of them that see shall be dim.
She said, no, read it one more time.
And the eyes of them that see shall not be dim.
And the eyes of them that see shall not be dim. Those of us who always knew something wasn't right about this place, and right. Something don't feel good about life, it got to be something more than life. You come into the truth, and now you see. Your eyes is not dim anymore. It's not cloudy. You understand all the things you always felt was wrong with this place. Now you begin to understand. Oh, that's why. Because the church is evil. No wonder I hated that place with all them women with them big funny hats that talk about each other and them men trying to have sex with me. You understand? Now I know why I always hated that place, because it was not where the Lord was. Read on.
In the ears of them that hear shall hearken.
In the ears of them that hear shall hearken. That day you walk by the camp and saw them crazy niggas you see every week when you leave them from work. One day you hear something that made you stop and say, oh, let me see what these crazy cats talking about. Why they got 666 on Jesus' face? Why these niggas got them funny clothes on? But that, you know, whatever people think when they see the camp, they stop for a second, they hear. They're like, you know what? White people is evil. They did destroy our people. Man, CIA bought crack in the ghetto? Oh, hell no. They start to listen. That's the time we in today. Read on.
Verse 4, the heart also of the rash shall understand knowledge.
The heart of the rash shall understand knowledge. All them cats that was too cool for school, nigga, I ain't doing no tests. I ain't studying no multiplication, nigga. I'm trapping. One day he hit a camp and he like, Jesus was black. The Bible, the same nigga that said, my old grandma, you leaving that Bible. I ain't trusting that white man book. And then you hit a camp and you like, what? Jesus was black. Moses was black. Solomon said he was black and beautiful. What the hell is that in the Bible? Grandma ain't never told me that. The heart of the rash is going to understand knowledge. A cat that would never sit in class and pay attention and take notes, coming to truth and be a cat that's like, what was that precept again, sir? What scripture was that? Call you on the phone at 3 in the morning. Salakia, sir, I know you probably sleep, but I just had to know, you know, what's going on in Psalms 147. Why the Lord saying this? I'm like, damn, this crazy trapping looking the cat want to know the Bible. That's the time we living in. You understand? The heart of the rash shall seek knowledge. Read on.
And the tongue of the stammerers shall be ready to speak plainly.
And the tongue of the stammerer shall be ready to speak plainly. That cat that always talked funny, was shy, and didn't like speaking in public, used to stammer a little bit, stutter a little bit. He coming to truth and blaze. You understand?
That's right.
He coming to truth and speak the word of the Lord clearly and loudly for everybody to hear. That's the time we living in. Read on.
Verse 5. The vile person shall be no more called liberal.
The vile person. Read one more time.
The vile person shall be no more called liberal.
Now, at the same time, the vile person is no longer going to be called liberal. Who is the vile person on the earth today? The white man. Guess what? We ain't going to look at the white man like, oh, they so loving. They give us welfare. They care so much. No. The vile person is not going to be called liberal. Black people are starting to see that the white man, whether he's a Democrat, a Republican, a Christian, an atheist, a Muslim, a Buddhist, he's the devil that the Bible speaks of. The vile person is no more going to be called liberal. Read on.
Nor the curl, said to be plentiful.
Bountiful. Nor the churl, said to be bountiful. What does churl mean? Another one of them words. If you don't know, let's look it up. I'm saying that because I don't know what the hell churl means. I was just thinking to myself, well, am I going to gloss over churl? Nah, let's go to the dictionary and find the definition of churl. All right. Boom. Churl. A rude, ill-bred person. A medieval peasant. A stingy, morose person. You understand? The churl is no longer going to be called bountiful. Who's the churl? That white man. Okay. This is a good scripture for politics. All right. You want to talk about the white man's political system? Today they call the Democrats liberal because they for the people and giving programs for the people, but they vile as hell. Them Democrats is the ones that's putting, you understand, Planned Parenthood in your community. They the ones that saying homosexuality is okay and we should let men that want to dress like women go use the women's bathroom, and we should teach kids about, you know, if you know you got two daddies at home, what they doing in the bedroom. That's the liberal. The Lord said the vile person is no longer going to be called liberal. Everybody understand? The churl is the white man, the Republican, the one that's stingy with his money, but you know, the one that wants to keep not pay no taxes. The scripture say the churl not going to be called bountiful no more. Why? Because a lot of them cats in Hollywood and them entertainers and them athletes, they end up being Republican because they want to keep all their money. The Lord said the vile person is not going to be called liberal no more. We ain't going to look at them crackers in the Democratic Party like, oh, they care about black people. The hell with that. Bernie Sanders, Hillary Clinton is a racist, hates niggas, always has, always will. She worked on every major political program that has destroyed black people. We're not going to look at them like they're liberal no more. The churl, the selfish, the stingy, the white man that want to keep all his taxes and openly hates niggas, we ain't going to look at them like, oh, Hollywood gave $1 million to the, you know, the victims of the tornado. You know what I'm saying? We ain't going to look at them like they bountiful anymore. They are evil, disgusting bastards that hate the black community, especially in the black community. Any black person that's rich, 9 times out of 10, they are Republican. They hate niggas. They hate the poor. They hate the ghetto. Everybody understand? The Lord said the churl is no more going to be called bountiful. Read on.
Verse 6. For the vile person will speak violently.
Villainy.
Villainy.
The vile person is going to speak villainy. What is villainy? They're going to speak things that go against the Lord. What is the vile person saying today? Come on with it.
Christ is white.
They saying abortion is a woman's right to choose. They saying homosexuality is an alternative lifestyle. They saying all lives matter. Hell, they saying black lives matter. Even the black lives matter don't give a damn about black lives because they ain't talking about abortion. And black lives matter is two dykes that run black lives matter. What about all the black men going to prison? What about all the babies being aborted? What about the black family being divided? You think them dykes is going to fight for black women to come and love black men? Hell no. They want your woman in their bed. They don't give a damn about black people. You understand? The Lord said the vile person is going to speak villainy. That's all you hear coming out of the mouths of people that are not in the truth. Evil against the Lord. Evil against our people. Read on.
Cut on concert.
And his heart will work iniquity.
His heart will work iniquity. All of the thoughts they're coming up with is destruction on black people. Read on.
To practice hypocrisy.
To practice hypocrisy. How dare the white man open his mouth against ISIS or against Muslim terrorists when the legacy of the white man in the Christian church is the Roman, is the Spanish Inquisition? What the hell can they say about terrorism? What the hell can they say about Islam when they murdered for hundreds of years? Millions and millions and millions of people.
Right.
Read on.
And to utter error against the Most High.
And to speak error against the Lord, man. All the evil that they saying about the Bible and about God. All of the movies about white Jesus and the show about white David. I refuse to watch it. Y'all seen the White David show? Come on with it.
I seen the movie. The one with Solomon, the white Solomon, yeah, the white David, the white Jeremiah.
It is evil. They speak in error against the Lord. Read on. So, like, I seen the video of Creflo Dollar the other day. The nigga said, the only way to please Jesus is to break the law. The only way you sin, you fall into grace. If you don't sin, then how can you have grace? I could not believe this, the words that was coming out of this nigga's mouth. It was the most evilest thing I've ever heard. He was saying, you must sin in order to please Jesus. Now, black people that don't know any better will hear that and go blow a rod. They'll go smoke some weed. They'll go, you know, buy an 8-ball of crack and trap on the corner because they thinking, well, the only way I'm going to get this grace is if I go ahead and sin against the Lord. You understand? That is destroying our people, speaking error against the Lord. Read on.
To make empty the soul of the hungry.
And they make empty the soul of the hungry. Black people in the ghetto is hungry, starving for some food. Starving not for food, but starving for the Lord's word. Starving for the thing that'll fix their life. These bastards make their soul even hungrier. Starve them even more. Come on, Ima.
I was going to say, the white man so wicked, they was sending all mills, and they said that starting 2007, they're going to make people work 20 hours a week for food stamps. Just for food stamps.
God damn, you got to work 20 hours a week just to get food stamps. Now, what if a job ain't going to hire you for 20 hours a week? Nah, you know what's even worse? The people who working full-time hours now going to get their hours cut. So that a part-time person can get a job to make food stamps. So if you need 40 hours a week to get a benefits package where you go to the doctor for free, they taking that away so you can get food stamps. The white man is the devil, the Bible speaks of. Come on with it, Ima.
And if you ain't working, you got to do 20 hours of community service.
Damn, you got to be a slave. You got to be a slave. That's slavery. Nigga, you want to eat, you got to come a report for free. Report for food. No more being a bum on the side of the road with a "we'll work for food" sign. The white man gonna put you to work for food. And if you don't show up for the 20 hours of community service, you starve to death. No longer will the liberal, the vile, be called liberal. Everybody understand? No longer will the churro be called bountiful. Come on.
They sent the same mail to my crib. I opened that joint. I looked at it.
So they warning niggas now. They letting niggas know now. As I'm telling you, listen, you got a full-time job, hold on to it. Because they taking that shit away. That is the white man letting everybody, and everybody getting that notice. The people with jobs getting noticed. The people without jobs getting the notice. Because they letting everybody know you only about to be working 20 hours a week. So get ready to be happy and live with it and deal with it, nigga. Because that's all we giving you. Everybody understand? The white man is showing everybody that we no longer holding you niggas up. We no longer giving you any handouts. You got to fend for yourself. Now is the time when we're going to have to come together. We're going to have to stand with the Lord, stand with one another. We're going to have to prepare for the days of the Inquisition again, because that's what's coming. You see the CIA and the NYPD. I seen them put a nigga in a body bag the other day, and he was alive. NYPD in New York threw a cat on the ground, face down, handcuffs behind his back. They picked him up, put him in the bag, and zipped the bag up and carried him and put him in the back of a van. Now, somebody recorded it, which means people watched this shit happen and did nothing. You understand? That time is coming again. The white man is showing you who he is, showing you his spirit. And the only way that history doesn't repeat itself is if you're aware of it. Everybody understand? That's what this class is about. Read on.
And he will cause the drink of the thirsty to fail.
He caused the drink of the thirsty to fail. That's what's going on in all of these religions. People are thirsty for something to fill their soul, and the white man is stealing it from them. The Christian church is stealing it from them. The Muslim mosque is robbing them of the water they so desperately need. Read on.
Verse 9. Verse 7. The instruments also of the curl are evil.
But on the other side of it, the curl, they evil as well. Donald Trump saying, I hate niggas. I hate Mexicans. We're going to build a wall and make Mexicans pay for it. we're going to get rid of them. You understand? That cutting all them programs is the government preparing for Donald Trump to be president. You understand? The instruments also of the curl are evil. Read on.
Are evil. He devises wicked devices to destroy the poor with lying words.
He come up with wicked devices to destroy the poor with lying words. Right now, the white man always talking about how much welfare is weighing down the system, right? Talk about how much is taxes. Do you know that 0.01% of the money America spends every year goes towards welfare? Imagine you got $1 million, right? Let's say American government had $1 million. If you had $1 million, $10 is what the white man spends on welfare. Now, you got $1 million, how much is 10? You gonna miss that $10? That $10 gonna break the bank. You gonna not be able to put gas in your car or pay your rent, keep your electric on if that $10 is missing? Well, that's all it costs to give niggas free food. And of all the people getting welfare, white people get more than everybody. White people get more welfare than blacks and Hispanics in America. But the white man on TV is always talking about welfare. People getting free money, getting welfare, they ain't working, they lazy. It literally cost the white man nothing to feed and clothe you. But guess what? He got wicked devices prepared against the poor. The white man just hates poor niggas. He wish you would die rather than be poor. He wish you would die rather than wear your braids and put on your boots and, you know, do whatever you do in the ghetto. He'd rather you just die or be like, you know, a faggot. Or be a hoe, be Nicki Minaj, be something he can put his penis inside of. If he can't do that with you, you're worthless to him. Everybody understands. The Lord said, the instruments of the curl are evil. He devises wicked devices to destroy the poor with lying words. It is a lie that welfare is weighing down America. It is a lie that it costs too much money to the taxpayers to pay for people who don't have a job. They trying to shut down Social Security. How many old people work their whole life just to be able to retire and have some money coming in? The white man want to take that from you. You understand? He's an evil, disgusting bastard. Everybody understand? Read on.
Even when the needy speaketh right.
Even when the needy speak right. Even when you go beg and protest and plead and ask the white man, please, please love me. Don't kill me. Don't hurt me. The white man still hates your goddamn guts. Everybody understand? Drop that. Go back to Ezekiel, the 35th chapter. Ezekiel 35 and give me 8. Give me verse 10.
Come on.
Amar, you get it.
Come on. We got the book of Ezekiel 35, verse 10. Because how it has said, these two nations and these two countries shall be mine, and we shall possess it. Whereas the Most High was there.
Who are these two nations and these two countries the Lord said the white man was going to possess?
Is it on literally on speaking about countries or people?
You tell me. Lord say two nations, two countries. Come on with it.
They're all speaking about Judah and no Ephraim, the 9.5.
He's talking about Judah and Israel, blacks and Hispanics and Native Indians. The white man said, I'm going to possess them. They're going to be mine. The Lord was there. The Lord was with blacks and Hispanics and Native Indians, but I'm going to be with them now. I'm going to make them mine. I'm going to make them belong to me. The Lord said, because the white man said he was going to take these two nations and take these two nations to these two countries and possess them. Read on.
God, Verse 11. Therefore, as I live, saith the Most High Power, I will even do accordingly to thy anger and accordingly to thy envy, which thou hast used out of thy hatred against them.
The Lord said, as I live, I will even do according to thine anger and according to thine envy, which thou hast used out of thy hatred against them. The Lord is going to use the white man's hatred to destroy him. What does that mean? Everything the white man devises to do to you, the Lord is going to do to him. White man would love nothing than for there to never be no more niggas to look at. But the Lord gonna make it so that there's never no more crackers to look at. White man would love to just murder and rape all niggas and get rid of them. The Lord is gonna destroy and let the heathens rape and murder all crackers and get rid of them. Everybody understand? All the evil torture the white man has devised for you, the Lord gonna give that to the white man. Read on.
God, my God. And I will make myself known among them when I have judged thee.
The Lord said, guess what? Them two countries, them two people, oh, they gonna know that I'm the Lord when I've judged you. We're gonna watch the destruction of the white man, and we're gonna say, Barakatah Yahweh, why Yahweh Shah. We're gonna know that the Most High is real in that day. That all of this time, all these years, all this suffering, all this turmoil, depression, sadness was because the Lord was waiting for deliverance, waiting for the time to deliver us. All of the suffering we've endured was because the Lord loved us. And plan for all of this to happen so that he could deliver us and destroy our enemies before our face. Read on.
Verse 12. And thou shalt know that I am the Most High, and that I have heard all thy blasphemies which thou hast spoken against the mountains of Israel.
The Lord said, you're going to know that I am the Most High in that day, and that I heard all the evil shit you were saying about my people. All of the things you was plotting in your United Nations councils, your trilateral commissions, your Bilderberg group meetings, you understand? The Lord said, I heard all of it, and I'm going to destroy you for it. Read on.
God of my God, saying, they are laid desolate. They are given us to consume.
That's what they said. All of the nations of the earth have said, these black people, this great mighty people that can run and jump and sing and dance and all do all these amazing things, they was given to us. That's why the East Indians sell you their hair. That's why the Koreans run the beauty supply store that you go to get your combs and your picks. I went to get something to tie my hair down with. I had to go to the Koreans and get. Couldn't find it in no black store. Ain't no black store to get a wave cap or a comb that I could use to pick my beard. You understand? I got to go to the Koreans to get it. My woman want to get her nails done, want to look pretty. She got to go to the Vietnamese to get her nails done, get her feet rubbed. You understand? That's these nations living off of us. That's these nations saying they was given us to consume, so let's consume. You understand? I had to talk with a sister the other day about Africans. I was like, you see Black Lives Matter marches on the TV, right? See black people protesting about all the death. See Africans out there marching with us? She was like, nah. So you see any Africans standing up about all the killing that's happening to black people? She was like, nah. I said, why you think that is? She was like, I don't know. I said, because they don't give a fuck about us. They don't care about us. As long as it ain't their problem, then they don't deal with it. That's these other nations. Everybody understand? Come on, Mara.
Time check 859.
Come on, wait. Keep reading.
Call my God. Verse 13. Thus with your mouth ye have boasted against me.
What the Lord say?
Thus with your mouth ye have boasted against me.
The Lord said they boasted against him with their mouth. Read on.
Call my God. And have multiplied your words against me.
And they multiplied. They kept speaking against the Lord. Kept saying evil against the Lord. Wasn't enough that they said Jesus was white. Wasn't enough that they said niggas was Gentiles and was born to be slaves. Then they had to go and say homosexuality was an alternative lifestyle. Then they had to go ahead and say that pork was the other white meat and that shrimp, crab, and lobster were delicacies. They had to say everything that goes against what the Lord put in his Bible. It wasn't enough to say that Jesus was white. They had to say his mother never had sex. You understand? It wasn't enough to allow homosexuality, they had to tell a black man he couldn't have more than one wife. Tell a black woman she could leave her man if she wasn't happy. They boasted their words against the Most High, and he heard it. Read on.
I have heard them. Thus saith the Most High power. When the whole earth rejoices, I will make them desolate.
The Lord said, when the whole earth rejoices, I will make you desolate. You understand? The whole earth is going to rejoice at the destruction of the white man. Now, what does that mean? All of them Hamites over there that's starving in the Congo right now, when Christ returns, they're going to be happy. Because guess what? Finally, somebody going to be on the earth to feed them. Now, does that mean Jesus loved the Congo and the Africans? No. Right now in China, there's a village where there's buildings just like this one, or downtown, you see all them big buildings where they got Chinese locked in rooms for 20 hours of the day making cell phones. You got that new iPhone or that new whatever Galaxy you got, just know that some Chinese kid was in the room for 20 hours of the day to make sure you got that phone. Well, guess what? They're going to be happy when your house shall return. They going to finally get to leave that little ass room. They get to go get some ice and get some whatever they eating. You understand? When Christ returns, all of the meek are going to now be able to eat, going to be able to live. And all of the rich that have gotten powerful joining the white man and loving his ways and murdering, killing, and enslaving, they are going to be destroyed. Everybody understand? The earth is going to rejoice when the Most High makes the white man desolate. Read on.
I will make thee desolate as thou didst rejoice at the inheritance of the house of Israel, because it was desolate.
Oh, the white man rejoices about niggas not knowing who they are, not knowing their identity, not having their culture. You understand? Calling yourself African-American and Nubian and Egyptian and Moorish and whatever the hell nonsense you believe, Rastafarian. The white man smiles at that. He sees a nigga walking down the street with dreadlocks and a Bob Marley shirt, and it makes him feel good on the inside. He see you with your shaved face and your suit and your tie with your Stacey Adams shoes, and he feels good on the inside. But then he walks by 7th and H in Washington, D.C., 15th and JFK in Philadelphia on a Friday afternoon, and here's the white man is the devil, and he defecates on himself. You understand? Defecate is number two. I don't know. The white man shamed when we stand out there on the street and tell him that he's the devil the Bible speaks of and tells our people to separate from him. Read on.
So will I do unto thee. Thou shalt be desolate.
Guess what? We're going to rejoice at the inheritance of the white man being destroyed. We're going to rejoice when they back to being the hairy cave beast that they started out as. We're going to take our children to the zoo to see white people. And our children are going to stand in the zoo and be like, ain't no way daddy, he used to run the earth. Ain't no way Bill Gates was that thing then. Ain't no way that, you know, George Bush was that thing. I'm like, son, listen, they used to run the earth. They used to have clean face. They put on suits and ties. You understand? And they used to run for president. I'm like, nah, you kidding. We're going to rejoice when their inheritance is laid desolate. Everybody understand? Read on.
Oh, Mount Seir and all Idumea.
Oh, Mount Seir and all Idumea. Not just the homeland, not just the government, not just the people in authority, but all Idumea, all white people. Not just Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton and the Bushes, but, you know, Joe Bernanke that lived next door. You understand? Kimberly Johnson, you understand? They going into slavery, too. They going to be destroyed as well. Read on.
Even all.
Even all of it, wherever they at, Italy, Germany, Poland, Russia, Ukraine, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, South Africa, you understand, the mountains of Tibet, you understand, Antarctica, we're gonna send missionaries to Antarctica to capture white people. They all are going to be desolate. They all going into slavery. Read on.
And they shall know that I I'm the Most High.
And in that day, they're going to know who the Most High is. Come on with it, Sharma. We're in Ezekiel 35. We started at verse 10 and went down to the end. Ezekiel 35 and 15 was the last verse, all right? Any other questions? Everybody solid on that one. One more scripture, and then we'll close the class. Give me Isaiah chapter 14 and 21. Come on.
Yeah, so what is the scripture where, I'm not sure, I'm paraphrasing though. They say where Christ is, he was talking about the, he was saying that it's not deeds that get you in the kingdom of heaven or something. Yeah, so, what, I mean, it's, if I'm right about that.
Okay, what is your question about it?
I need you to break that scripture down if you can find it.
All right, I'll do it next week. You wait till the end of class, you know what I'm saying?
You ask me.
No, don't sweat. Okay. Scriptures say, okay, when Christ says it's not works that get you in the kingdom, meaning
but it's faith, you
said. Faith is what?
Works.
Faith is an action, right?
Okay.
You can't have faith unless you're doing something to show your faith. You show your faith. Okay, faith is not, people think that faith is, I believe in Jesus. That's not faith. Faith is I'm keeping the law because I believe that the Lord will forgive me for the evil I've done before. That's faith. Faith is, I believe in Christ, so I'm going to do what he said to do, even though I used to be an evil, wicked bastard. That's faith. Because without faith, I should just die now because I sinned before, right? I've done sins that are worthy of death. If I don't have faith, then I should just die. I'll just keep doing evil till I die. But if I have faith, I'll serve the Most High, hoping that he'll forgive me for what I've done in the past. That's faith. That's the works of faith. It's keeping the law. You're not going to get into the kingdom, though, because of those works. You're going to get into the kingdom because of the Lord forgiving you for the evil you've done before.
God.
You understand? Come on with it.
Is it because the Lord going to forgive all Israel, or?
He's going to forgive those who deserves it. You deserve forgiveness by your faith. By starting now to be perfect, the Lord will forgive you for all the evil you've done before. That's faith. Does you understand?
Count, but okay. So sloppy. It's not by those deeds you said.
Meaning you're not gonna get into the kingdom based on the things you did before. You were evil before the truth, right? Okay. You're not getting into the kingdom because you was evil before the truth. You're going to get to the kingdom because of the faith that you have now, because of your righteousness now. Okay. That's what gets you into the kingdom.
That's what that is?
That's what that's talking about. The things you did before the truth, before you found the Lord, before you knew about Christ, those things aren't going to get you in the kingdom.
Sure.
What will get you in the kingdom is having faith now. Having faith means you obey the Lord, means you keep the law. It means you follow Christ. You understand? That's faith.
Yeah.
All right. Everybody understand that?
I just didn't understand where it's.
Yeah, because the works not going to get you in the kingdom through you all. The deeds. The deeds is talking about the evil you did before. The evil you did before is not going to get you in the kingdom.
Can I prove that a scripture or something?
Yeah. Okay. Bring it out next week. Okay. I'll break it down and show you that it's not talking about the good you do now. But it's talking about the evil you did before. Everybody understand? Most High Christ. No script, no spec. Last scripture, Isaiah 14 and 21.
God on my God. Isaiah 14 and 21. Prepare slaughter for his children.
Prepare slaughter for his children. These white people, you bring up the Spanish Inquisition, what white people gonna say? I wasn't there. I didn't do that.
God.
That's not my Catholic church, not my religion. And you're gonna say, okay, no sweat, Mr. White Man, but guess what? The Lord said, prepare slaughter for his children. Read.
God of our God. For the iniquity of their fathers.
For the iniquity of their fathers. Well, guess what, Mr. White Man? You ain't had slaves, but somebody got to pay for the Spanish Inquisition. Somebody got to pay for the 100 million that died in Europe and 177 million that died here in America. Somebody got to pay for it. Somebody got to be brought to justice. The white man is going to be brought to justice. The Lord said, prepare slaughter for his children. For the iniquities of their fathers. Read on.
God of our God. That they do not rise.
That they what?
That they do not rise.
The right man is forever going to be on the bottom. Forever going to be a slave. Read.
Nor possess the land.
And guess what? He's never going to own land. Never going to own property. Never going to be a dignified human being. He's going to be a slave forever wherever he goes. Read on. Isaiah 14, 21. Read on.
God of our God. Nor fill the face of the world with cities.
And guess what? Crackers is not going. There ain't gonna be no more Cracker Town. Ain't gonna be no more Jewish neighborhood, Italian neighborhood, Irish neighborhood. They just gonna be, you know, the dog kennel. They're gonna have kennels for white people. You know how you take your dog to the white people? I don't know if they got them in Philly, but in DC they got dog parks. Where it's like every 10 blocks is a spot in the city where it's a little plot where white people take their dogs and run around. Because it's the city, they dogs can't run around. So the white man take their dogs and let them run around in the dog park. Well, we're going to have an Edomite park. You understand? It's the middle of the day. We're going to have a barbecue. Hey, man, bring your Edomites on. Let them go ahead and socialize in the park. You understand? Edomites get to go sniff each other's behinds like dogs do. Hey, get away from there. Bob, what the hell is wrong with you, Bobby? Go crawl over in the corner somewhere. That's how white people going to be, Lord, allowed in the kingdom. Everybody understand? You understand? The white man is evil. He's murderous. He's treacherous. And all of his evil deeds are being exposed through the work of the Lord and the mouths of the priests and prophets in the Israelite School of UPK. You know what I'm saying? With that, I'll pass class over to Priest and Officer Marat.
ISUPK.
You done heard 1,000 times before that there's no history of the Israelites ever being in Egypt, right? What if I told you that I found the city of the Hebrews in Egypt, hidden in plain sight? And I'm going to bring it out at the Passover. This Passover 2016. I'm going to drop today's word.